great pleasure to introduce our panelists, beginning here and proceeding in alphabetical order. Mr. Mauro Fenzi is CEO of the international process automation supplier Comau, which is active throughout Europe, Latin America, and the US, providing products and services to clients that include all of the major automobile manufacturers. He previously worked in the aerospace and petrochemical sectors, specializing in advanced automation. A warm welcome to you. Great that you can be with us. Standing next to him is Susanto Irwan. He is founder of Sensify Security, and he is also a serial startup entrepreneur. At Sensify, he has built a team to realize the vision of applying blockchain technology in cybersecurity for the industrial Internet of Things, and seeking to boost the Internet of Things resilience, flexibility, and cost efficiency. Great that you could join us. Next to him is Dr. Jan-Michael Mrozek. He is the CEO of the Digital Factory Division at Siemens, and previously he served as CEO of its Energy Management and Power Transmission Divisions. As you know, ladies and gentlemen, Siemens is Europe's largest manufacturing and electronics company, active in four sectors that are all closely associated with the industrial Internet of Things, namely energy, industry, healthcare, and infrastructure and cities. Warm welcome to you. Next to him is standing Kartik Natarajan. He is Senior Vice President and Global Head of the Engineering, IoT, and Enterprise Mobility Practice at the global IT and business process solutions provider Tech Mahindra. He's an expert on digital transformation strategies and is also a member of the IoT Solutions World Congress Advisory Committee, as well as an active member of the Industrial Internet Consortium. A warm welcome to you as well, sir. And finally, it's a great pleasure to have with us Professor Dr. Ing Stefan Reimelt. He is CEO of GE Germany and Austria. He was previously president and CEO of GE Europe. He's also a professor of process engineering at the Technical University here in Berlin. And GE, of course, is the proverbial company that needs no introduction, perhaps just this. GE does see the industrial Internet of Things as its singular focus, and analysts put it more directly still. They say GE is betting the company on the industrial Internet of Things, and we're going to hear from him right now whether he, in fact, also sees it that way, because I'm going to ask all of you, proceeding in this direction now, down the panel, to very briefly answer for me this question, please, namely, what is the major change that you see for your business from digitization? And we just heard this very interesting keynote saying that many, many companies, especially smaller scale ones, are seeing this more as an incremental process, that it will increase business flexibility, but not necessarily transformative for their business models. So perhaps you can incorporate a thought about that in your remarks. Stefan Reimel, get us started, please.
Yeah, good morning. Thanks for the introduction. Yeah, let me start it and explain it. 6 years ago, we started to think about that, you know, big data are going to play a major role. And the good thing about competition is it kept us awake, and we had to look for a platform in order to increase our service business, in order to do predictive maintenance and these things. And we looked around in the market and didn't find a platform. So GE, you know, thought we're big enough to do that. And we developed 6 years ago our platform called Predix. We recognized the most important thing is you have to be in a relevant ecosystem in order to do that. Because even as GE, we recognized you can't do it alone. You don't get the speed if you do it alone. So you go there where the most relevant ecosystem globally is existing, and we decided that we sit today with 1,800 people in Silicon Valley. We are a major part. Some of my colleagues here on stage are using Predix, so to speak, already. We developed the platform. It's an open platform which is able to work with unstructured data in amounts which are, you know, mind-boggling. Think about my flight this morning coming from Frankfurt. On one jet engine, we generate 1 terabyte of data in a flight of 35 minutes, and you can imagine what that means. So we recognize the most important thing for us is productivity gain. Last year we took internally in our 490 factories, we took around about 730 million out of productivity gain purely through digitalization out. And we recognize that we want to not only roll it out for GE, we recognize that our clients are very interesting on this. So we structured an open, secure, and transparent platform on which today we have 20,000 developers, we have 400 partners on it and over 100 apps, because we recognize there is a lesson to be learned out of the industrial, or out of the consumer internet, and that is, it's a platform game. And we believe there are going to be a couple of companies who are able to have a relevant platform, and with the technical domain expertise we have, and we are sharing openly, building digital twins and things like this, we developed an edge-to-cloud platform, which today is being highly appreciated, and it changed our company. It was a transformation step, and these transformation steps are bold decisions. We would say you're either in or you're out, because it changed the company, and it made us a very better company, which allows us to be competitive, and I think that's known. We drive that very much, and we roll it at the moment globally out. We just yesterday announced a big cooperation with a very prestigious German company, Bosch. We announced the first deal with the Deutsche Bahn, another big German icon. And so we believe that we are on a good way, but it's key thing. You need to be in an ecosystem, you need to be fast, and you have to recognize you can't do it alone.
Thank you very much. Mr. Natarajan.
Thank you. We looked at digital as both an opportunity as well as a threat. And we see that about 30% of our businesses would go away by 2020. And we also want to double our revenue. We are about $4.5 billion company. We want to be a $10 billion company by 2020. And we expect 50% of our businesses to come from digital, from the current levels of 20%. So which essentially means we expect digital to quadruple in the next 4 years. And we see digital in a simplistic way, about 3 V's, 4 D's, and 5 strategies. And 3 V's are about volume of data, and what is that you're trying to do in terms of velocity of the data, and value of the data. And we are trying to see how do you think we understand these 3 V's. And the 4 D's are about data capture, data storage, data analytics, and data monetization. And how does it translate into our business? We are looking at data capture as whether it is customer data, product data, factory data, supply chain data. How do you think we can help our customers to transform in their business? So we are looking at about 5 service lines that we are betting on for 2020, and which are to do with customer experience, Internet of Things, Industry 4.0, analytics as a service, and security as a service. So we believe we need to move from the conventional models to as a service model. And that's the transformation journey that we are on.
Thank you very much. Mr. Mrozik.
Yeah, I think it was repeatedly said, digitalization is something that is really disruptive, that changes almost everything in business life, also in personal life to some extent. It changes time to market for companies and can optimize that. It changes and optimizes flexibility. We talked about the lot size of one of, for example, the sneaker that people wear, and that's bespoke and has the individual design that somebody would like to have according to his biometries. We're talking about increase and optimization of efficiency in plants and efficient use of assets and cost efficiency, and quality is being increased as well. These are the tasks that we have to deal with in modern industries, and digitalization helps to get these topics optimized and therefore make companies more competitive. That's what's the groundbreaking difference between them, and this is why it's almost a must for any company to enter digitalization in order to make use of the opportunities that it presents. We believe that at Siemens that the whole value chain of a company needs to be looked at. It's not just about taking data out of a product, it's not just about optimizing manufacturing, it's about starting with the design of a product, digitalizing this and creating a digital twin of a product. In the second step, creating a digital twin of the production, because product and production cannot really be distinguished. You need to design a product in such a way that it can be manufactured in a cost-effective way and vice versa. So a digital twin of the product and of the production is required. Then there needs to be a seamless approach from these digital twins, product and production, into the production process and the automation part. There needs to be a seamless workflow that optimizes this. And then at the end of the day, the platform comes that takes the big data, analyzes it, and feeds it back into production and into the design process in order to, in a closed loop manufacturing kind of way, optimize the whole process overall and yield into a closed loop manufacturing process. This is the breakthrough, and only with this kind of holistic approach we can optimize the whole company. We at Siemens have been embracing this for a relatively long time. We started in 2007, when we were already a very strong automation company, to acquire UGS, to get into the digital and the software field, and we've been acquiring 15 more companies in the meantime in order to round off our portfolio and really have a holistic end-to-end approach to digitalization in a manufacturing environment. And just a short word on what we have achieved so far. Our factory in Amberg, for example, has been increasing the output since 1990 by a factor of 9. We're producing 1,200 different parts and products in this factory every second, one product. In 24 hours, we get it from the ordering process to the doorstep of the customer, and we have a quality level of 99.9989%. And we have been increasing the output without adding any headcount to it, so we've been keeping the headcount constant. A customer of ours, and that's well known to Mauro Fenzi in this environment, is Maserati. They're using this holistic approach as well. They brought the new Maserati Ghibli into the market recently, decreased the number of months to get the car into the market, the time to market, from 30 months to 16 months. They're producing 70,000 different varieties of this car, and they're getting 3 times more of these cars out of the same footprint than before, and that tells you about the disruptiveness of digitalization in a holistic way.
Thank you very much. Mr. Irwan?
Thank you for the warm welcome. I think everyone agrees that the value of digitalization is humongous. Now, with the adoption of the Internet of Things comes with the need to increase the security of the Internet of Things. And that's exactly what we are seeing in our business, and that's actually why we started Sensify Security.
Say a word, you were so brief, which is great, but just say a word to us, please, about the application of blockchain technology. Was the decision to found Sensify Security driven by the availability of technology or by a perceived need created by the link up in the industrial Internet of Things?
It's absolutely both. So the need of security and also the availability of some of the technologies required for us to provide a total security, especially when the environment is very decentralized. In industrial world, not everything can be connected 24/7 at all times. So the need for security, especially in authentication and authorization, is truly required to operate even with intermittent internet connectivity. And that's exactly what we are focusing on.
Very interesting, and we'll come back perhaps and hear a bit more shortly. Mr. Fenzi.
So good morning, first of all. I will try to be short. As Comau is doing robots, so is in the middle of the revolution. But to be honest, we are learning how the changes are going to affect the business model of our activity day by day. So we keep an high-level frame active, but we try to play outside the box, which is quite important. I agree with the previous speech of Tobias. It's very tough today to define the value proposition in a short period of time because everything is changing very fast. And the speed is really key for the organizations, because if you don't digitalize your company, it will be quite impossible, I think, to digitalize the application and the business model. So now, as in Comau, we are mainly working on speed of the organization, agility, and the last point I want to highlight is really what we call digital human manufacturing, because it seems that the workers are not in the center of the game. They are, and we need to learn how to apply digital transformation to manual manufacturing operation pretty fast.
And we will definitely come back to that point a little bit later in the discussion. So let me dig now a bit deeper on this business model transformation process. And because it is very, very rare to have both GE and Siemens on one panel, I'm sure the audience can appreciate that. I'm eager to use that opportunity to see if we can tease out any differences in approach. The Economist, basically, they are the ones who wrote that GE is betting the company on the industrial Internet of Things. They certainly see a slight difference in approach. They say, essentially, GE all in on this, moving quickly, whereas Siemens taking a slightly more deliberative approach. So I'd be curious to know whether the two of you see it that way, and why. What accounts for the difference? So I'll start with Mr. Reimholz and then go to Mr. Mrozek.
I agree.
Your mic, please.
I agree there's a little bit different. And by the way, I'm not the only one who frequently stands here. We had a lot of discussion in Germany when it came to Energiewende, where Siemens and GE have total different approach, particularly in Germany. So it was very interesting. But let me put some fuel into the fire. it is true. At first, people strongly believe that competition makes you stronger. And competition, you know, enhances the speed in development. And so we like that challenge. That's something which is in our DNA and so on. But in the digitalization world, it is you alone, even as a big company, you are too small and you are too slow. So you need, and I mentioned again, you need to sit in a relevant ecosystem, which we're at the moment missing a little bit in Europe. And that's I think it's a very fair statement. Now, our approach is, of course, quite different because in our DNA, automation, or let's say digitalization, is not the next step of automation. That is too short-sighted by far. We talk about big data and we talk about analytics and we talk also about productivity gains, which are much beyond. I was yesterday in a presentation with a typical German Mittelstand machine company, and they showed
an the SME value. For the, our non-German speakers, an SME.
An SME, sorry, thanks, an SME. And actually, it was not anymore an SME, it was a big SME. But they showed their value chain. And out of the 10-hour value chain of getting an order in and sending an order out, manufacturing was precisely 5 minutes. So, you know, I think I don't agree too often with this statement of being disruptive. This is a word which is not true. If in your business you have an inefficiency like Uber and taxi, you know, with taxi, then yes, you are disruptive. But most of the time we're talking about simple productivity gains. And I think, you know, disruption is a strong word. If inefficiency is so big, like for example in Germany, we have 25 days of negative power prices. Well, yes, that's very clear. That will be disruptive. Nothing will look the same as we recognized after the energy transformation. So let's look at the big things. And the key thing is that we need an overarching platform who allows us from edge to cloud to really make sure that you are able to work with this data. So the combination of OT and IT is a challenge. That's where we have to focus. It is not operations alone, and it's definitely not IT. If we talk to the IT guys and tell them what kind of terabytes of data we need on unstructured data, I mean, they have a problem. That's why we didn't find somebody who could help us. And so let's face it, it's not an automation play. It's too short-sighted. It's much more.
Thank you. Mr. Mrozek. Where do you see, where can we tease out some differences there?
You know, the point is, I even agree to a lot of what you're saying, so there's not much fuel in the fire. We need a very holistic view, and that's what I said right from the start, that this is very much required. And this is why digitalization, at the end of the day, really requires that we start from the design of products. That's the beginning of the value chain. We create digital twins. We get into the digital twins of the manufacturing, and then the real automation and the manufacturing starts, and I totally agree that in the first steps of engineering and the design of products and in the R&D, we can really create a lot of efficiencies that will change to a large extent the environment that we are working in. And you know, we have engineering advantages and reductions in engineering time that are as much as 30%. If this is not disruptive, I don't know what we can call disruptive as far as efficiencies in companies is concerned. And then, at the end, we also need a platform, or we call it operating system, that takes data out of the systems. That's the one that you have described, and it plays a very important role, no doubt about this. And this is the way, and this is the reason why we also build it ourselves, by the way, and this is the competitive approach that we're taking. And I fully agree that this platform is something where we need an ecosystem, where we provide an operating system and others provide applications on top of it with their knowledge and their expertise and their usage, because they know their machines best, they know their devices that they produce best, and they can analyze it and send it back into the production environment and into the design environment. That's the holistic view that we're taking, and that's the big picture that we were asking for, and therefore I fully agree. Big picture, ecosystem, and digitalization is not only automation plus, but it involves automation, because only seamless approaches from design to the big data are the ones that offer the best efficiencies and the best digitalization gains, and that's what we're all looking for.
Brief follow-up question on monetizing data streams with the request for very brief answers. I recently, no, actually not recently, I several years ago already heard a speech from the CEO of a division of one of your companies, and I'm not going to say which one it was, whether it was Siemens or GE, who basically said, we are putting these machines out there and they are generating data, also return data, that is of incalculable value. But it's hard for us to figure out exactly how we monetize this. So where do the challenges lie, and what needs to happen in order to really make that resource work for you? And again, brief answers if you would. Mr. Weimuth?
If you would ask a GE guy today what keeps you awake at night, that's exactly the question. That suddenly, so to speak, a company comes and being able to work with this data more efficient than we doubt that because of our domain expertise, but that's exactly where we have to watch, and that's why we have to be in an ecosystem which is, so to speak, turning everything upside down. You have to be part of that.
Mr. Mozick?
Yeah, the data is being provided through the machines. By the way, looking at these machines, we need kind of edge computing that first of all decides what kind of data is sent into the cloud, because we need to make sure that the valuable data is being sent out, and any company, I think, would like to first of all own the data themselves that their machine produce. And secondly, they would have the right to decide who's going to do what with these data and who's going to monetize them. That's why we follow a concept where the data is being stored in a cloud, that's in our case the MindSphere operating system, and the application programmable interface that this platform provides actually provides for any company, either third parties or an OEM that builds a machine, or for somebody who uses the machine, the capability to put an application on top that does the analysis. And what then can be done is different business models. This application can be sold by the OEM. That would be a software business. It could, on the other side, be a service to evaluate the data and give the machine user, for example, the OEM in a car manufacturing environment, an advice that this machine needs to be maintained. Or the OEM, the machine builder, could provide services as a full package to the user in order to, for example, in a performance contract mode, guarantee the uptime and availability of these machines. So these are kinds of the business models that can be used in order to monetize these data, and I'm sure there's a lot to come, because the crowd that's going to produce all these applications is going to, and that's the sense of crowd innovation, is going to make a lot of ideas out of it.
Thank you very much. So let me now come to a couple of other points that were addressed here in the course of the morning, also in our film. Another aspect that the film mentioned was the possibilities for individualization. So no longer mass production, but very much tailor-made to needs of customers. I see you shaking, nodding your head, Mr. Fensi. Your company, of course, has traveled a long way. As I understand, it began as an automobile parts supplier and has evolved significantly. Is this part of the most recent and future evolution to be moving away from that old mass production model?
Oh yeah, it is already reality, because also my teams are not sleeping very well, because the customers, they want the same quality, cost, and repeatability of the mass production into the new world, which is customize the production, the products according to the customer needs in a very short period of time. So the challenge we have now is to mix the new requirements with the old benefits of automation and digitalization. But I think that with the IoT possibility, we can really achieve the final target for these customers, which is to get the quality they want, the cost they want, but in a short period of time and with the customization needed. I like always make an example, because also the plants are moving to the retails sometimes. Glasses, you know that the people, they like to choose the colors, the materials, and then to get the glass ready in maybe a couple of minutes. So now many, many companies, also in Italy, are studying the idea to move some of the manufacturing process in the shops, which is really the revolution we are looking at, and the IoT means will help a lot in this.
Thank you very much. What's keeping your clients awake at night, Mr. Natarajan? Everybody's been mentioning some cares and worries, and of course that was also a subject of the keynote we heard there. You do serve telecoms clients all around the world. Where do their uncertainties lie, and what does that mean for your business model, the transformation of how you're working?
Sure, I think what we realized in the last few years, especially if you take the telecom customers that we serve, while we do have about 50% of our business on the enterprise side, I think from the telecom, the voice is free, data is free. Now they're looking at IoT and trying to really get on with value-based models that they can evolve. And at the same time, this is not their core expertise. So they really need help from outside. And they thought they can use the current network to monetize for IoT, but then there are new networks that are evolving, whether it is LoRa or narrowband, and they're also concerned which is going to create significant amount of investments that need to be made. And what we are seeing is trying to map the customer journey. How do they see their business in the next 5 years? And a lot of telecom customers tend to become specialist in entertainment, specialist in healthcare, specialist in retail. So we are seeing that they would really start becoming a specialist in one or two areas, which is something is a typical trend that we are seeing. So in a mad of gold rush, this is what my CEO used to tell us, the ones which make money is the one who are providing the shovels. So we want to be the ones who will provide the shovels in making our customers' transformation journey happen. So we are creating our businesses to be defined as run, change, and grow. So run is to keep the lights on, and change, trying to help them to offer platform as a service, and grow along with the customers like a startup. We are trying to work like a startup. So we have identified about 5 mini CEOs who lead our businesses as startups.
I'm glad you mentioned that. Let's go to the startup on the panel. We often hear that big companies need to act like startups, and it's become very fashionable for big companies to associate themselves with incubators and startups in the hopes that some of that will rub off on them. Do you think that works, Mr. Irwin?
Well, in the Silicon Valley, what we saw is that billions of dollars are being invested in startup company. And the reason is that startup companies, we are not tied to a particular agenda of a big company, typically. We don't have to serve a list of customers who are currently paying millions of dollars. So startup could really take higher risk. We can really move faster and innovate more and more and really push the boundary. And with the adoption of IoT, as I mentioned earlier, it comes with significant growth of security vulnerabilities. We saw a power plant being taken by the hackers. We saw IP cameras being also taken to execute the largest denial of service attack. Now, in industrial and manufacturing, we have existing systems, control systems, we have RTUs, we have, at the same time, we want to integrate the new devices, the IoT. So this integration, we are trying to connect things that were not connected before, perhaps not designed to be connected before, to be connected. And with that, a lot of security concern, which could be slowing down the adoption of IoT. Yeah. So that's why we are very excited to push the innovation, push the boundary, and help the adoption of IoT.
May I just ask you, in conjunction with that flexibility that startups have that you just mentioned, what role does failure play for you? Again, that's one of the mantras, fail fast, fail forward, yeah. Move on. Yeah. You've, I think, now founded three companies. This is the third.
That's correct.
So any failures in there?
Never, no. I always believe that failure is actually the beginning of a success. Oftentimes, we might be brought down because of a failure, but it's actually only the very beginning of success. In fact, if it's possible, fail as fast as you can, because you can save the amount of dollars associated with that particular failure, and then coming up with a solution. But in the perfect world, it's always iteration. It's always you build one thing, and then you build another, and you build on top of your previous success or previous failures too. So if possible, fail fast, learn as much as you can, and iterate over that.
Can big companies really incorporate that kind of an approach into corporate cultures that have been around for a long, long time? You know, there is a saying in Silicon Valley, a big established company cannot disrupt itself. What would you answer to
that, Mr.
Well,
there's a lot of truth to that, let me share some insights here that's maybe interesting. Of course, when we get together as office of GE, you know, you can imagine that in the last 5 years, we had a lot of guys without ties with sneakers, half my age, and telling us how to run the company. That's pretty embarrassing. And very often you fly home and say, wow, why shall I not do it? And to be honest, I had a startup here in Berlin, which I was running myself, just to try it if it's possible. It was possible, big success. We built a hybrid power plant here in Berlin, big success, great. But then you have people who are really gurus in Silicon Valley, like Eric Ries, minimal viable product, an inventor of a lot of process, business processes, which are increasing the speed of your company. And then you sit there and say, wow, minimal viable product, and you build a jet engine. Well, I don't want to sit in that plane. And so, you know, you have to take and you have to learn of these things. And we created out of minimal viable product, we created, so for example, a process in GE, which is called FastWorks. You know, we have 2-3 years later than Siemens developed our H line, which is the biggest turbine on gas turbine on Earth. We brought it out in half the time. We have today 60% of the global market, and we just 2 months ago did the world record on performance, 62%. It was only able by, you know, throwing a lot of standard processes overboard, bringing new people into it, task force and we call mission-based teams, which were able to, you know, brought different thinking into it. So yes, it's possible, yes, you need it. And I think when you participate on a GE meeting, simplification of the organization is the name of the day. I mean, you know, we have to reinvent ourselves permanently. And an example in the digitalization, after 1 year development predicts, we made a decision that it's the wrong concept. It was a closed system, and we recognized that there was so much demand from our clients, so we opened it up, we brought it to the world, we let a lot of people participate on it, and have a lot of developer on our platform, which again brought us speed and a lot of different microservices which we increased today. So I think there's a lot of lessons being learned.
Mr. Mozik, any divergence there?
The answer is always hard work. In a startup, it's hard work to be successful. I think that doesn't come on its own, and the success doesn't come by itself. Also in a big company, it's something that you need to work hard for. And there is internal measures that you can take in order to speed up innovation. That's separate groups, people that you give kind of a startup environment, a certain budget, and they go along and they speed up the development very, very quickly. So these are means and measures that usually work, but let's not forget about two other measures that are very, very important. You need blood, you need innovations, you need ideas from the outside, and that can go through mergers and acquisitions. So you buy companies, and a lot of startups are actually after a certain phase being bought by big companies in order to get the influx of new ideas in there and people with fresh ideas, and that's great, a great way of innovating. And the second one is that we created a group within Siemens called Next 47, 47 because Siemens was founded in 1847 and we want the new founders in there, and this group is highly autonomous and it works together with startups in the world in order to get ties and connections in there. We support them personally in terms of being successful. There's management capacity, there's funding available, there's processes and things that might help them in order to get into the market. We help them also with their go-to-market in order to make them more successful, and then at the end of the day we bind them closer to us. So there's different measures of big companies of being very innovative and quick as well.
Thank you very much. Let us move on to another topic that was addressed in several of the different remarks that we heard this morning, and that is the issue of cooperation, also between companies, between countries. It was mentioned here, digital ecosystems, the buzzword to talk about that. But I'd like to dig a bit deeper and ask a couple of you what that really means for you in practice and where you see the greatest need, but also the challenges and the obstacles. So I'll begin with you, Mr. Fenzi.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about speed. And again, I have to come back to this point, because if you want to be faster, we need to open doors and listen to the external people. And for a large organization, this is not easy at all, because the people, when I ask them to prepare an innovation plan, usually in the past at least, they were preparing a 3,000 activity line plan with a 3 years duration, but they were telling me, Mauro, don't worry, this is very safe. In the meantime, the world was changing. People like you were coming to the market. So I was really pushing my teams to be open and to talk with the international organization, to talk with the startups, and to learn from them how to do it. The companies now are doing this very well. We have many contacts. We know each other very well. Every day we work together. The governments have to do the same. They have to be very fast in defining the standards on which we can play everywhere, because otherwise we will be in trouble very soon, because without a standard frame, will be quite impossible to follow the market needs.
Thank you very much.
Well, as a startup, it's not quite magical. Obviously, our success, we depend on close integration with all of the enterprises, right? So a startup company, we might come up with new idea, new innovation, but we need to integrate with the existing ecosystem. I think this is where an ecosystem like Industrial Internet of Things, or sorry, the IIC, the Industrial Internet Consortium, is very important, because within that consortium, there is no more boundary. Anyone who can, who would like to participate, can make a suggestion, can make a proposal on joint test beds. And these test beds can be owned by multiple companies. There is no border for that. And I think this partnership is very important.
Mr. Natarajan?
I think it is important to recognize the culture that exists within the company. There are definitely bimodal. One, you have very seasoned, experienced engineers and leaders, and you have millennials on the other side. So how do you think you can actually balance in terms of the strategies that we are trying to adopt? How do you think we can engage the whole organization? So what we recognized is we created Growth Factory, which is essentially led by millennials. And they help in working with multiple partnerships at different levels. One, startups. Two, we want to leverage the innovation that is happening around the big corporates, be it in terms of GE, Cisco, HP, Microsoft. How do you think we leverage some of the innovation that is happening around them? And three, also encourage the internal employees to come up with ideas that they can go and incubate themselves. So we are trying to really bring in the ecosystem by working with startups, working with large corporates, as well as trying to encourage the internal innovation to happen simultaneously.
Okay, so clearly all of you walking the walk on digital ecosystems. Let me ask perhaps both Stefan Reimelt and Jan Wozik to comment on standards. It was mentioned a number of times today as a very crucial area for cooperation. We are going to be devoting more discussion to it this afternoon and tomorrow. But from your point of view, how much do the divergent standards currently out there really hinder development of the IIoT? Mr. Mozhik?
Yeah, as I said, we need, in order to benefit from digitalization in a holistic way, through a value chain that is really streamlined and comprehensive. And talking about all these systems that are in there, from the software systems that design the products, simulate the production, do the production at the end of the day, and then create the data, they're connected via the Internet of Things. And between the software and the hardware portions of it, there's obviously also interfaces that need to be connected. In other words, this market, this business and digitalization as a whole is extremely dependent on interoperability, because in real life we very seldom see scenarios where just one vendor is at the end of the day going to do everything in a company's environment. And connectivity, interoperability, and standards are the precondition for this market to unfold and for this market to develop, and at the end of the day for everyone who plays in this market to benefit from it. And therefore standards are the precondition, or one of the preconditions, to make this work.
Stefan Reimold, if you had a message for our hosts, would that be right at the top in terms of wish list for G20?
Well, whatever we saw on regulation, I think we have to recognize some are good because they enhance and they nurture, so to speak, development. But when you look back, I mean, just take a simple example in Europe. We came up with the toughest data security or data privacy laws. We started in 2012. We ratified them in Brussels in 2014, and we're going to bring them 2018 into power. Well, we're going to live in a different world in 2018. So we have to recognize what's what we call post-factisch, and some of these regulations don't meet the speed of development. And I can give you tons of examples. I mean, I'm still getting, for my photovoltaic roof, 20 euro cent, which is a shame, you know, because we already can build PV plants for 3 euro cent. So guys, we have to recognize that technology is faster than regulatory settings of rules. And then one thing very clear, the biggest driver for volatility in the marketplace is the regulator themselves. So we would be very happy to, that was not enough. We need a little more appreciation here. I'm saying certain things because the deputy has left already, but the key thing is that's the fact. It's a fact, and I think you'll be changing this, and to be very honest, I'm coming here to Berlin one day a week in order to feel the pulse of the politicians, because if they change a regulation or a scheme, when we develop certain things, I mean, the development of Predix took us 3 years, 4 years, and we spent a couple of billion. So if they change certain things and saying, well, we're building certainly a German platform and that's going to be excluded, well, you know, long-term investment going to be changed. So we have to communicate with the regulators very much by saying, hey, watch what you set as a standard. We have a saying, you know, have an open field, let people walk, and then see what you have to regulate and where the standard going to be set. So I would approach this from a different way.
Thank you very much. I'm going to make a cut there and go on to one final area, very, very critical. We will be returning to it at different times in our conference, but I'd very much like to get your input. And that, of course, is the future of work. We sometimes hear experts talk about the end of work. In our film, we saw a factory. There was one person in a white coat and a whole bunch of robots. So my question to all of you would be, we've just heard technology often moves faster than regulations, faster than policy frameworks. It also often moves faster than the training of the workers. What are you doing in your companies to bring workers along? And do you see a massive fall, drop off in jobs? And if so, what does that mean?
No, I don't see the drop. Like we didn't see the drop during the third revolution. When PC has been coming to our desks, most of the people were discussing the same points. They were afraid of them, job losses. We reshaped our skills, and we got a very good value from these tools. And the same is with this revolution. We have to be very positive. The number of robots per worker, for example, in Germany, we are talking about 300 robots per 10,000 workers. So up to now, we have been able to replace safety critical jobs to help production to get efficiency, but with limited number of robots. This will not be disruptive on the people working in the plant. As companies, we will have to learn how working with the people in order to be more effective. So we have to remove the fences of the robots out and start really talking with the people, working together, and find a different value proposition.
Your company's been around since the mid-80s, I think, 87?
Even before.
Yeah, even before. So clearly yes. You've got some older workers. What do you do to bring them along in terms of training and education? What are the biggest needs?
Yeah, we have in Comau three different levels of schools in the academy, in Comau Academy, working at different levels, from the workers to the executives. All of them are talking about digital manufacturing, and they're not only for us, but are also for our customers. And every year, from a master we have in Torino, we recruit 25 young master students into our organization to reshape really the age and the working style. We have just to prepare the people to the revolution.
Thank you very much. How does it look at Sensify Security? Do you have anybody working for you?
Absolutely. As a technology company, the value of the company is actually in the people. In fact, we talk a lot about innovation, but where is the starting point of that innovation? Where did the idea come from? It's from the people. And the idea doesn't actually care about what's the age of the person, right? So it can come from anywhere. So making investment, making sure that people are happy, they're motivated, at the same time providing the right level of training to get them up to speed and have collaboration. You need a mix of people with different background, perhaps with different age group, with different level of experience to come up with the best idea. And that's the fuel to innovation.
Jan Brozik, Germany has this vaunted system of dual education, truly one of its great economic strengths. What kind of challenges is digitalization posing there? Is the system up to the challenge? Is it adapting to the extent that it needs to be? Or are you facing, for example, shortages?
Yeah, what we clearly, I think the system is great, and it's actually something that a lot of countries worldwide look at and would like to copy it. So it's not about the system as such that needs to be changed, but of course we need to renovate and change the content. And we need to make sure that more digitalization-related content is being introduced there. And we'll see that a lot of manual work will go out of the shop floor and will be replaced by observing. We'll see in the construction departments a lot of work that's going to change because we're not going to build mock-ups anymore. We'll have the digital twin to look at within a computer environment. And the people need to be used to these tools and need to deal with them in order to efficiently adapt digitalization. Our experience, however, is that when we introduce digitalization into factories, and we're just about building a new metal-related Industry 4.0 showcase factory in Bad Neustadt in the northern part of Bavaria, that people really embrace it because the work gets extremely interesting. The content is interesting. People get along. They want to do it, and they want to work with it. And this is very, very encouraging. We are supporting this at Siemens with a very, very dedicated and very sophisticated system. We have Siemens Professional Education. There is 25 fields that have been identified of know-how that we need to get into the company and that we need to teach our employees with. And we are regularly matching the competence profile with what is being required and then trigger the necessary training courses in order to make sure that people are up to the job and that they have the competence and the know-how to do that. So it needs a very sophisticated and very structured way of taking the people along, and only then you get the support that is required in order to successfully introduce digitalization.
Mr. Natarajan?
I think this is a very, very challenging question for us, and we have about 110,000 employees as part of our company. And there was a conference 6 months back. One of the researchers asked a question, how many machines report into you? I said, sorry, I didn't understand the question. They said, you have all the humans reporting to you, or you also have some machines reporting to you. I thought that was a very a stunning question to really look at how the future would look like. So which essentially means creating some kind of an artificial intelligence bots or something which will really take away your jobs. It could be virtual assistant. It could be something which can take away some of the basic things that you do every day. But I think it's important to recognize the change that is coming in. And I definitely want to believe that this will, automation and artificial intelligence will take away some jobs, but it will get replaced with different kind of jobs. So that is the concern that we have. How do we reskill our people? And we are seeing that whether it is the digital 101, 201, 301, 401, which is essentially what we are trying to take it across the organization, getting all the 110,000 to be trained on 101, and 30% to get trained on 201, 10% getting trained on 301, about 5% on 401. So this is the journey that we are on, and this is a real challenge and issue that we contemplate every day. And we identify top 20 skills on a yearly basis and start mapping them with reference to the skills that are available internally.
I realize Tech Mahindra is an international company, but if we look at the mother company in India in particular, India faced with an enormous population bulge, you say some jobs will fall away, but they will be replaced by other jobs, or those people will move into other jobs, but within the company or doing something altogether differently? And what is the Indian government doing to make this transition compatible with that population explosion?
So we from NASSCOM, along with the government, in trying to work as part of the National Skill Development Program, and we constantly keep watching the curriculum in the colleges and what can be taught as part of the vocational courses. And a lot of courses like data analytics is being taught at the colleges today, which was not the case 5 years back. And we don't expect the people who come out of the college would be directly employable. We want them to have more than one skill, which was okay 5 years back. So we are trying to continuously keep looking at the curriculum and the training and the internship that we can offer before they can really start getting into the corporate world.
Thank you. Stefan Reimer?
Well, let me say two things. In the 80s, we had what we called computer integrated manufacturing. Highly automated factories, one guy only in a factory, light out, and what happened to the employment? And today, you look at the German economy, and let's say that, you know, we are very well off, we have very little unemployment in young people, we have a top education system, and I think it boils down to education. And let's take the last number. In Germany last year, big companies, as well as the public service, have cut around about 450,000 employment, and medium-sized companies in Germany, SMEs as you call them, the Mittelstand, has generated around about 500,000. So there is something which is really very healthy here. And in my opinion, I have to admit, the German education system is something which really helps to get people off the street and does a wonderful job there. And I think we don't appreciate that much, not enough about it. But I think we are in front of a transformation, and in transformation we as a company have to take social responsibilities. We have to make sure what all my colleagues are saying, I just have to say the same thing, is we have to take people and re-qualify them, re-skill them. And, but we should not forget at the moment we have a worldwide trend which is called the new currency. The new currency in trade is labor. And so the new currency is labor because people or governments are investing billions and subsidizing a market, and they want to make sure that these subsidies at the end of the day are ending up with local people. And so I think we have to get ready, and the challenge is going to be for companies who are big or small, that you have to be globally presented. You have to be globally there, because if a country gives you subsidy, they want to get labor in back charge. So I think that's something which we have to deal in the future much stronger, which I think that's a trend which is, I think, very challenging for everybody, because these global manufacturing, highly automated factories going to have a stress because you can't move them so fast. And maybe factories, so to speak, out of the box, maybe the future manufacturing spaces which we will face. And don't forget, I mean, GE just invested a handful of money in regards to 3D printing. So You have a nicely automated factory, and suddenly we put a 3D printer into it, and we print our injection nozzle of our jet engine there, and you don't need any kind of automation in regards to a lot of factories, because it's only one machine. And if this machine is there, well, we can put it even into the service center of our clients. So there is another thing which we have to take care of. So let's not look only at what happened today. There is a huge future out there.
Thank you very, very much to all of you. Can we please give them a very warm round of applause, ladies and gentlemen? That was a very, very interesting discussion.